Hello everyone, the topic is distraction osteogenesis. Now this comes in the orthopedic surgery. Now when the patient, they have grown up and they have some skeletal problems which leads to facial asymmetry, malocclusion, etc. Then we have to go for orthognathic surgery. So this is also a concept which is related to the surgery. Now we come across some clinical situation in which there is deficiency of the bone and the bone growth is required as a part of a treatment modality. So now we know one option to treat it, that is the use of the bone grafts. Now bone grafts is basically a material that you're using and you're increasing the size, width or anything. But now there are various disadvantages of using this graft, like we need two surgical sites. One is the recipient site and one is the donor site. Then there are chances that the body, it will reject the graft or it will lead to morbidity of the donor site, etc. So these are some disadvantages of the graft. And because of all this, it limits their application. And hence, there is a technique which is introduced that is known as distraction osteogenesis. Now, as the name says, osteogenesis is nothing but the formation of the bone. Genesis is the formation and osteo is the bone. And distraction is nothing but you're moving something apart. And by moving that apart, you form a new bone. So the definition of distraction osteogenesis is, it means stimulating the spontaneous new bone production between vascular bone surfaces which are moved apart by the gradual separation. So separation is nothing but distraction. Now we will understand this definition by the help of this diagram so that you can understand what exactly it is. Now over here, this is a hypoplastic mandible. That means your mandible, it is small in size. So you want to increase the size of this mandible. Then what you do in this distraction osteogenesis is, first you fracture this bone, because now this intact mandible, it is very difficult to increase the size with the help of this distraction osteogenesis. So what you do is you fracture the bone by the corticotomy. Now that you have fractured this bone, so it becomes mobile and it becomes very easy to manipulate this bone, because now this becomes very fragile and now you can move this bone very easily. Then you start with the distraction osteogenesis. Now distraction, it is done with the help of a device which is known as a distractor. So this is a device which is known as distractor. Now this is your fracture line. So you will apply this distractor device on this two segments. Now basically you have done the fracture. So there are this first segment and second segment of your bone. So you'll apply this distractor on this. Now about this distractor, like what are the parts and everything, I'm going to explain, because this is a very commonly asked question that you should know even in your vivas. So this distractor, it is a device which is used in distraction osteogenesis, which helps to separate the bone. So basically this is a distractor. So this distractor, it has various parts, that is it has some screws, these are the arms. So what happens in this is you open up, you loosen up the screws, so the distance between this arm, it keeps on increasing. Now over here you can see, so you have loosened up the screws, so the distance, it has increased from this. And again over here, now you can see more you're loosening it up, so the distance of this arm, it is increasing. So it will create this pressure on this segments of the bone. So this is what exactly the distractor does. So it helps in the distraction, that is it separates this bone segments, this two bone segments of the mandible. Now when it does that, so this is the space or the gap which is created by this distractor device. And now this segment, it is moved at the rate of 1 mm per day. So basically you're moving this 1 mm per day. Now there's this gap which is created with the help of this distractor. Now as you are loosening it up, so the distance, it keeps on increasing and you are going to increase it till how much mm you want. Now it is well known fact that the bone, it has the capacity to fuse and heal with the surrounding soft tissue, and it has the capacity. Over here this is a stretch fiber, so now you are stretching the fibers. So now the bone, they have the capacity to heal and to fuse. So what happens with time is, now this gap, it is filled with the new bone. So this is how it is, like the gap, it is filled by the new bone and it is healed. So this is how it looks after the treatment. So now you can see over here, so this is the after treatment and this one was the before treatment. So the size, it is increased with the help of this new bone formation, with the help of the device which is known as a distractor. So hence it is known as distraction osteogenesis. Now again we are going to see the definition so that we'll understand it well. So it means stimulating spontaneous bone production. So this is the bone production between the vascular bone surfaces. So these are your bone surfaces. So you're producing this new bone between this bone surfaces, which are moved apart by the distraction, by the device which is known as a distractor. So in distraction osteogenesis, this occurs that the gap which is created, it is now filled with the bone as the tissue triggers the growth factors, which in turn signals the cell to form the new bone. So now when this gap is created, so what happens is your bone or your body, it triggers the tissue that you have to produce new cells to fill this gap. So this is how your new bone, it is formed in this gap, and this will lead to the increase in the size of your hypoplastic, like whatever bone it is. So the discovery of this technique, it was first attributed by Cody Villa in 1905, and Elizarov, he is considered as the father of distraction, and he developed this distraction theory, which is known as law of tension stress effect. And Rosenthal in 1927, he coined this term, which is known as this distraction osteogenesis. So these are some things that you need to remember, as they are commonly asked in MCQ. And even if you get a LAQ on this distraction osteogenesis, then you can include these three things in the introduction part of the distraction osteogenesis. Now we are going to see what are the disadvantages, advantages, indications and contraindications of this distraction osteogenesis. So the first advantage is avoiding the second surgical site. So over here, you are doing the surgery on only on the one side, as compared to the graft. Now in graft, we have seen we require two surgical sites. So this is the advantage. Now the next is it avoids the graft rejection. So now we know, like we have seen in the disadvantages, that the graft, it is sometimes rejected by the body. So over here, there's nothing like this. The next is the soft tissue, which is surrounding the bone, it is also regenerated. Then it is seen that the nerve, it also grows in such cases. Then it can be used to lengthen, as well as you can increase the breadth. So you can increase the length or you can increase the breadth of the bone with the help of this distraction osteogenesis. The next advantage is in this, the relapse rate, it is very less. So that means you do not have to go for the surgery again, because in this, the new bone, it is formed itself by the body itself. The next one, it does not hamper the bone growth when you are performing this in the growing children. Advantage is it can also be done in the grafted bone. So if you have done the grafting, so after that you want to do distraction osteogenesis. So in that case also you can go for this. Now what are the disadvantages? So the disadvantages are in this, the patient's compliance is necessary. Now you have to apply this device, that is your distractor device. So in that case, the patient compliance is very necessary in such case. Now in this, the duration is longer. Then it requires two surgery. Why? First you are applying, first you go for the fracture, then you apply that device, and then you remove this device. So basically it requires two surgeries. Then there are chances that the device, it can fail. So this is the most common disadvantage. The next disadvantage is it is technique sensitive. So when you're applying this device externally, so there are chances that it can lead to scarrings. Then it can lead to infection sometimes. Then over here, it requires meticulous treatment planning and expense of the procuring device. So these are the disadvantages of distraction osteogenesis. Now what are the indications? So indication is it can be used in the reconstruction of the post-traumatic or post-resection segmental defect. Now if you see that there's a very big tumor, so in that case you remove the tumor, and after that you will see that the bone is also removed with that. So in such case the bone, it is reduced. So in that case you can use, so for the reconstruction of the post-traumatic or the post-resection segmental defects, you can use this distraction osteogenesis. The next is it is used in the reconstruction of the resorbed alveolar bone. So when your alveolar bone, it is resorbed, so you can use this distraction osteogenesis in that. The next is it can be used in mandibular hypoplasia. So it can be like in Pierre-Robin syndrome, Treacher's colon syndrome. So it can be used in such scenarios when your mandible, it is less in size. The next is it can be used in maxillary hypoplasia. So it can be like cleft maxillary hypoplasia. So these are like some of the syndromes which are associated with the short like maxilla or mandible. So you have to remember that distraction osteogenesis is nothing. So whenever the size of the bone, it is small, so and you have to increase the size, so you are going for distraction osteogenesis. So it is obvious that if the size is more and you want to reduce it, so you don't go for distraction osteogenesis, as the name only says that you're producing some new bone. So you have to remember it very well that this is the basic like indication that whenever there is hypoplasia of any bone, then you can go for the distraction osteogenesis. The next one is it can be used in the expansion of the constrictor palate. Then it can be used in the widening of the narrow mandibular arch. Then it can be used in rapid canine retraction. Then this distraction osteogenesis is also indicated in the TMJ ankylosis. Then it can be used in the closure of the cleft alveolus. So these are like the indications of the distraction osteogenesis. Now what are the contraindications? So first contraindication is it cannot be done in generalized bone disorder as osteoporosis, osteogenesis imperfecta, then osteopetrosis, etc. So you cannot go for distraction osteogenesis because if there is any bone disorder only, then how the new bone will form? The next one is if the patient, they have poor compliance. So you obviously cannot go for distraction osteogenesis as this is the main disadvantage of this DO technique. The next one is if the patient, they had the history of poor fracture healing. So if the patient, they had fracture earlier and they see that the fracture, it is not healed properly. So you are not going for this distraction osteogenesis. The next one is the aggressive jaw tumor. So when you will see that there are aggressive jaw tumors, so in that case, you cannot go for this distraction osteogenesis. The next one is pre-existing TMJ disorders. So the chances of improvement as well as the worsening of the problems, they are very more if there are any like TMJ disorders which are already present. And the last contraindication is if the patient, they are only not willing for the multiple surgery. Now in this we have seen the disadvantage that we require two surgeries. So if the patient only says that no, we don't want to go for such long treatment, such long duration of treatment, so in that case you cannot go for distraction osteogenesis, and in that case you have to go for BSSO or any other technique. Now we'll see about the stages of the distraction, which is like very commonly asked as a SAQ and in VIVAS too. So basically this distraction osteogenesis, they have 5 stages, that is osteotomy, latency period, distraction period, then the next stage is consolidation period, and the last one is the remodeling period. So first one, as the name says, it is osteotomy. Now we have seen like we fracture the bone. So osteotomy is nothing but the bone, it is manipulated and you are fracturing the bone. The next period is the latency period. Now what you have done is now you have fractured your mandible. So you have fractured the mandible. So what you do in latency period is in this you are not going to activate this distractor device and it is used for this immobilization of the fractured bone. Now you have fractured the bone. So there are chances like if you start with the treatment at the same time, so there are chances that your treatment, it will fail. So what you have to do in this latency period is you're not activating the device, you're not activating the distractor, and you are just immobilizing this osteotome like bone. So the latency period, it extends from the time of osteotomy to the beginning of the active distraction. So this allows the time for the primary healing to initiate and the fibrous union to be formed between the osteotomy surfaces. So in this you will see that there is a primary bone callus which is formed, and this distraction protocol according to Elizaro, so he said that it is like 5 to 7 days of the latency period. And some literature, they report it as to be 0 to 14 days. So this latency period is 5 to 7 days or it is 0 to 14 days. Now if the duration of this latency, it is too short, so it will result in improper callus formation and it will lead to the failure of the consolidation. So if the latency period is too large, so it will lead in the ossification of the callus and it will lead to the failure of the distraction treatment due to calcification. So it should be like optimized, that is 5 to 7 days or by some literature it says 0 to 14 days. It should not be too long or too short. So this is the next period, that is known as latency period, that you are not going to do the any activation of this device. It is just the formation of the primary bone callus. Now the next period, it is known as a distraction period. So this period, it is during which the two osteotomized segments, they are moved apart, usually at the rate of 1 mm per day till the desired length is achieved. So this is, as the name says, distraction. So in this you will start with your distraction, that is you are going to start with the moving apart of this segment. So now in this phase, the traction force, so now this distractor, so the device, this distractor, it will apply the force on your segment, and because of that only the bone, it moves apart. So what happens is, So the traction force that is delivered to this bone segment through the distractor, it induces the new cell formation and it will lead to that distraction gap which we have seen earlier. So the frequency of the distraction and the rate of distraction, they are very crucial during this phase. Like how and how much you're going to apply the forces, so that is very important, and the ideal one is 1 mm daily. Now the fourth phase, it is known as, or the fourth stage, it is known as consolidation period. So it is a time which is taken for the bone filling, that is the calcification, to occur between the distracted and the osteotomized segments. So now over here, now we have seen that there was a gap which was created. So in this consolidation period, what happens is there is the calcification of this gap. And you have to remember that the distractor device, it is held in place till the bone matures completely. So first, you know, there is formation of the woven bone and then there is formation of the mature bone. So you have to keep that whenever you have like attend that proper mm which you want. So what you do is you are going to keep that distractor device in the place until the bone, it matures completely, and the distractor, it is removed at the end of this stage after the radiographic evidence of the complete osseous continuity is seen. So you are going to remove the distractor after this fourth phase. So the range for this period, it is around 4 to 12 weeks depending on how severe the problem is. Now there are various literature which are given that you want to accelerate this stage. So now we have seen that it requires 4 to 12 weeks and the average is 8 weeks. So in literature it is said that you can accelerate this consolidation period. So there are several osteoinductors which are used to accelerate this phase, the consolidation phase, which are incorporated into the callus. So reports of use of, what you can do is you can use BMP2 or you can use PRP or growth hormones or osteoblast like cells which are derived from the mesenchymal cells, etc. They have been recorded, like with the help of these different cells, you can accelerate this stage. So the maxillary bone, it requires longer time for consolidation than the mandible. So this is a very commonly asked MCQ, that which bone it requires more time for this consolidation period. So it is the maxilla. So your maxilla, it requires more time than the mandible. And the last phase, it is known as a remodeling phase. So the period of the remodeling, bone remodeling, after the removal of the distractor, it is known as a remodeling phase. So it starts with the full functional muscle load, which is followed by the continuous shrinkage and remodeling. So at the end of this consolidation period, you remove the distractor. Now after you remove the distractor, there is this remodeling phase in which the bone and whole of your structures and tissues, it remodel itself, and this is the end of your distraction osteogenesis. So this was all about the indication, contraindication definition, then advantages, disadvantages, and the five stages of distraction osteogenesis. So this was all about in this first part of this video. Now in the next part, we are going to see about the various classification. Now there are various classification which are given for this distraction osteogenesis. Then we are going to see mainly about this distractor device. Now this distractor device, it has various parts. So we are going to see about that. And even we are going to see about the biological process, like how exactly all this occurs, like what exactly happens in this distraction osteogenesis. So this was all about the first part of this distraction osteogenesis. I hope you found this video helpful. And if you did, then please like, comment, do share it with your friends and do subscribe to my channel. Thank you so much.